the figure that's up on the screen, there's causational links resulting from exposure to discrimination on a Right, so the turtle dotum, I'll be presenting the turtle dotum as well. So we'll be going into, some of the sessions that were created are according to the initial bed dotum system. So Gordon Wandabin Spa explained that when the seven primary dotums take care of their responsibilities, then there should be no issues for us to be concerned about. Gordon also described that the people of the turtle clan are responsible for mediation, justice, making laws, and helping with decisions if there are disagreements between clans. So in order to understand, challenges, barriers, and overrepresentation within the justice system, we need to first understand colonization. Our Anishinaabe were forced to conform to European concepts of decision-making, lawmaking, heterosexual, and other norms and values that were forced upon us. These forced conformities changed our Anishinaabe systems, values, and norms. A huge impact of this is gender inequality. This occurred because colonizational laws placed higher value on men and devalued women. For instance, women could never hold title to property. So recent studies and research has shown impacts of forced conformities and exposure to discrimination and racism. So if you look at the figure that's up on the screen, there's causational links resulting from exposure to discrimination on a personal level, institutional level. Institutional level is like our systems, social systems, jail systems, correctional systems. And then at a national level, is, the body of Canada and the body enforcing these legislations such as the Indian Act and any other legislations that enforces systematic racism and discriminations. So in some of the impacts of adverse exposure to discriminations include decreased ability to deal with discrimination. So we do generally see a lot of hopelessness and helplessness within our First Nations, giving up, and of course, overrepresentations. There's increased internalizing behaviors such as negative beliefs, isolations, depression, anxiety. There's also increased externalizing behaviors such as violence, lateral violence, deviance, substance abuse, all within our communities. All impact overrepresentation. So overrepresentations are limiting opportunities and life chances for our Indigenous individuals. It is also forming the basis for vulnerabilities and increasing their likelihood of being a statistic. Traditionally, when we talk about decision-making, our Anishinaabe communities made collective decisions. This meant that as a community, we had a community process where major decisions over how to address issues that arose were decided. This included input from children, youth, adults, and elders. However, it was done in a way to honor the person's stage of life. Children were asked questions differently as compared to adults and elders. Yet this process was undermined in colonial decision-making processes, and that ultimately led to inequalities and injustices. When we talk about lawmaking, the Indian Act does allow for First Nations to make laws, and when the First Nations adopt the land code that follows the framework agreement on First Nation land management, we can also create laws in the areas of land development, protection, and possessions. However, even though these inherent rights, we have these inherent rights and lawmaking abilities and authorities, Many First Nations have faced numerous challenges on implementing laws and making laws. Some of the challenges include bylaws made under the Indian Act may not be compliant with the Charter of Rights and Freedoms and therefore cannot be enforced. Also, challenges with different levels of government, such as municipalities, provincial governments, and federal governments. There are also limitations to what the First Nation policing programs can enforce. And it was noted by the First Nation policing programs that there is a need to educate for the policing to enforce these laws. There's a lot of confusion when trying to enforce these bylaws. And then when we look at criminal law, for over 30 years, there's been several commissions of inquiries and three Supreme Court cases, such as R versus Gladue, R versus Wells, and R versus Ippoli, which identified systematic discrimination within policing, courts, in the correctional institutes, such as jails, and other justice-related institutions. Yet systematic discrimination is still occurring, and increasing incarceration rates are alarming, particularly to Indigenous ancestry. For instance, presently 23% of the federal incarceration population is Indigenous. And since 2005 and 2006, there has been a 43% increase within the Indigenous inmate population. And one in three federally sentenced women are Indigenous. Indigenous women are also most likely to be a victim of a violent crime as compared to the general population. Indigenous youth are also overrepresented in the youth justice system and are more likely to be placed in custody when compared to their non-Indigenous peers. In 2017-18, slightly over half of girls held in provincial and territorial custody were Indigenous. Restorative justice, it came about since the late 1990s. It is an approach to justice that seeks to repair harm by providing an opportunity for those harmed and those who take responsibility of the harm to communicate. Integrating Indigenous culture, traditions, and traditional legal concepts, such as our collective decision-making within restorative justice models, has shown to effectively reduce recidivism rates. The Chippewas of Rama has successfully implemented an Indigenous-led model that is called the Bidabin Restorative Justice Program, which they believe in. Studies confirm that this started the community's path to healing. The model, however, has not been replicated as there has not been available funds to all communities. However, some communities have implemented their own restorative justice programs, but through different means of funding. In 1999, the Gladue case was presented to the Supreme Court, where the principles governing application of Section 718.2/E of the criminal code were instilled. So Gladue's intended to reduce incarceration rates among individuals who self-identify as Indigenous. Gladue ensures that courts and judges consider unique circumstances that derives from adverse effects of colonialization, racism, loss of language, removal from lands, Indian residential schools and Indian day schools, child welfare and foster care systems. However, Gladue is missing a key component such as the availability of culturally appropriate rehabilitative programs and services due to lack of funding. There's minimal services and programs to help Indigenous offenders with intergenerational traumas and/or colonizational effects. Although Gladue has been implemented since 1999, overrepresentation in the criminal justice system has only increased. When we look at UNDRIP and addressing root causes in implementing, you know, UNDRIP articles and protections, we can help to decrease overrepresentations within criminal justice systems. Otherwise, it is noted that continuing problems of colonialism, social and economic marginalization, and systematic discriminations will continue to occur and result in adverse effects. Again, when we look at this figure in regards to causational links from exposure to discrimination and racism, we can understand that the effects of colonialization creates overrepresentation, especially in Indigenous individuals. Some relevant UNDRIP articles that are related to justice include, you know, Article 1, Indigenous people have the right to full enjoyment as a collective or as individuals of all human rights and fundamental freedoms as recognized in the Charter of the United Nations, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and international human rights laws. Article 2 states that Indigenous people are free and equal to all other peoples, and they have the right to be free from any kind of discrimination. Article 3 states that Indigenous people have the right to self-determination and freely pursue their economic, social, and cultural development. Article 8 states that Indigenous people have the right not to be subjected to forced assimilation or destruction of their culture. And that the states shall provide effective mechanisms for prevention of and redress for depriving them of their integrity as distinct peoples, of their culture or of their cultural values and ethnic identities. We also need to aim or effect of dispossessing them from their lands, territories, and resources, and any form of forced population transfer, which has the aim or effect of violating or undermining any of these rights. Any form of forced assimilation or integration, and any form of propaganda designed to promote or incite racial or ethnic discrimination directed against them. Article 18 states the right to participate in decision-making in matters which would affect their rights through representatives chosen by themselves. Article 20 states the right to maintain and develop their political, economic, and social systems or institutions. Indigenous people deprived of their means of subsistence and development are entitled to just and fair redress. Article 21 states that the right without discrimination to the improvement of their economic and social conditions, which includes the areas of education, employment, vocational training and retraining, housing, sanitation, health, and social security. And again, the states need to take effective measures where appropriate, and special measures to ensure continuing improvement of their economic and social conditions. There should also be particular attention paid to the rights and special needs of Indigenous elders, women, youth, children, and persons with disabilities. Article 22 states the rights and special needs of Indigenous elders, women, youth, and children, and persons with disabilities in the implementation of this declaration. The right to determine and develop priorities and strategies for exercising the right to development, and have the right to actively be involved in developing and determining health, housing, and other economic and social programs affecting them, and as far as possible to administer such programs through their own institutions. Article 27 states shall establish and implement in conjunction with Indigenous people a fair, independent, impartial, and open, transparent process that recognizes Indigenous people's laws, traditions, customs, and land tenure systems, which also recognize and adjudicates the rights of Indigenous people pertaining to their lands, traditionally owned or otherwise occupied or used. Article 34 states that the right to promote, develop, and maintain their institutional structures and their distinctive customs, spirituality, traditions, procedures, practices, and in the case where they exist, judicial systems or customs in accordance to international human rights standards. Article 35, Indigenous people have the right to determine the responsibilities of individuals in their communities, and states shall take appropriate measures, including legislative measures, to achieve the ends of this declaration. We're almost done. Article 40, Indigenous people have the right to access, and promote decisions through just and fair procedures for the resolution of conflicts and disputes with states and or other parties. And then Article 44 states that all the rights and freedoms recognized herein are equally granted to male and female Indigenous individuals. So I do have some questions for discussion. So I'm just gonna read some of the questions. Are there any other justice-related matters missing from the above discussion? What justice issues do you see as a priority that should be included in Canada's federal UNDRIP action plan? What discriminations should be addressed in regards to justice matters within criminal law? What kind of legal recognition or protection is needed for Indigenous justice matters in Canada? How can the federal government help to improve the judicial circumstances of Indigenous people in Canada, such as access to funding, reducing discrimination, et cetera? What kind of legal recognition to Indigenous people's laws, traditions, ceremonies, customs do we need? And what kind of processes would you like to see over the next 10 years to make federal legislations change in the social realm for Canadian federal laws to be reflective of UNDRIP? Right.
Good afternoon, everybody. Please feel free to use the chat if you want to ask your question and not have to speak. That way we can answer some of your questions as well.
Pat, just so that we can all look back and read them. John, did you raise your hand?
Hi, can you hear me? Great, perfect. So I just had a general question was how, I know we're talking federal and law, but how, if at all, will this impact or can it impact provincial or municipal law?
So presently it doesn't impact that unless Bill 76 is implemented, then it will trickle down to provincial and municipal legislations.
Yeah, just because a lot of my concerns, I guess, are mostly around provincial law, namely, harvesting MNRF. If I, go hunting or fishing outside of my treaty area, then I'm going to get charged with hunting or fishing without a license. And I absolutely refuse to get a license just because I feel like I'm giving up my rights. So that's just a lot of my concerns are generally around provincial law.
So that is something that I can definitely put in our paper in regards to, because I do present this case paper to the chiefs prior to us providing it to Canada, and we can ask them to push for the Bill 76.
That would be great, because I know the MNRF, because I've written them a letter, because I think it's insane that happens. And I got a generic political response back, basically hiding under the veil of, I can't remember what the case law was, but it was something to do with East Coast fisheries, saying that, you know, basically the workaround is to get a letter from a First Nation, you know, approving you. But yeah, there's been instances where I know people that were, you know, elder or a group of elders from a specific community, and this individual wasn't from that community, it wasn't from the treaty area, and he ended up getting charged with hunting without a license.
Yeah.
The elders with, you know, with the community, but he didn't have that letter. Like, it's just, I don't know, crazy.
Just a couple of comments here in the chat from Rebecca to everyone. I think we need to include discussion surrounding environmental justice and environmental violence. And she said, yes, exactly, John. And then Tanya said, agreed with John and Rebecca.
Perfect. I'm right.
That's good. Sorry. I was just going to say, you know, same thing with, you know, environmental justice. Like, I know MNR, again, you know, particularly, so I'm from Rocky Bay. I'm currently in Thunder Bay. But, you know, I know their MNR was talking about bringing back the caribou. So they would essentially, you know, for lack of a better term, you know, playing God, trying to relocate caribou back into this area. But by doing so, they were planning on, you know, ripping up roads and, you know, not allowing access to, you know, what would be our traditional lands. So being able to have a say in those matters to benefit.
Mm-hmm. A positive thing though is that BC implemented federal and provincial. So if we could follow their steps and hopefully implement that within the provincial implement UNDRIP for the provincial legislations, that would be, you know, ideal, because a lot of our lands issues are provincial. And that's one of our top priorities so far, that I noticed a lot of people are, you know, it shows a lot of people are concerned for our lands and environmental justice and violence and the mining stuff and whatnot. Anyone else have any questions or ideas to bring forth in regards to justice matters?
I think one of the questions on your for discussion maybe what discrimination should be addressed in regards to justice matters within criminal law? And I mean, that's an important issue as well, if anybody has any comments on that. Mm-hmm.
It's Dan here. I'm not sure about that. But I was thinking about the child welfare system and how we have an overrepresentation there, which you can imagine that it probably precedes the overrepresentation in the justice system as well, right? And I think that we should really focus on something there as well. And also, I had a question about your last question. What kind of processes would you like to see over the next 10 years to make federal legislation change to in the social realm? Do you know, what type of implication or engagement will have in the creation of the 10-year action plan that the Department of Justice is supposed to be, you know, presenting in June 2023?
So they're looking, so we're doing a paper, so Anishinaabeg Nation's doing a paper. I believe there's a few different other, like Treaty 3, NAN, a few other organizations are all, and the Métis Nation as well is involved in this. So MNO, so they're all presenting what they would like to see in the action plan. And then they'll present back to us what they have gathered through all like First Nations, Inuit, and Métis.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's just not like, we're just not doing it. I know there's other organizations that are looking into UNDRIP and doing engagement sessions and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I was just wondering if we would have a bigger role to play in the actual like development of the plan, and then I work for the federal government, so I work for the public works, and they're doing an internal exercise as well to try to identify legislations, policies, and procedures that are not in line with the UNDRIP. And so I just wanted to find out, you know, like on this side of the coin, like our involvement in that plan. But okay, that's interesting. Thanks.
You're welcome. And I believe there's going to be consultation, right, Linda? Like over the next 10 years, like proposed legislative changes, and then consultation with the First Nations, Inuit, and First Nation Métis. Sorry. And then present it back, and like there's going to be a lot of back and forth.
Awesome. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're welcome.
Okay, we have Tanya. All criminal laws in Canada are biased against Indigenous people due to the reasons and systems which created them, namely to remove Indigenous people. Indigenous people altogether. I don't know which specific laws need to change, but my guess it is most, if not all, which were identified in the articles as well.
Yeah. And everyone, and we could see everyone like trying to grab different legislations and issues and whatnot. And it's all coming together. Like we noticed the Schooling Act that was going against Article 10. You know, there's the language. Remember the elders brought up that they're not bilingual. And then we see an article that came up from the federal government saying that they're not going to give bilingualism to the Ojibwe language. So there's those that created, you know, those two that are, you know.
That was also requested and submitted to Parliament through the Inuktitut language. And they denied that as well.
So those are the injustices that we're trying to look for and gather, and so that we can present to create these changes. And again, it's not going to happen overnight. It's going to take us, you know, 10 years to do this. Is there any other injustices that you see, even if it's not related to criminal? We could talk about different injustices, because I still am writing the report. Did everyone see the survey? I have a survey. It is for all the Dodems, however, but it does get your opinion in. So I'm just going to find that right now. I'm going to share the survey in the link here.
Oh, Rebecca has a comment here. I feel like there is so much to touch upon. How will the Anishinaabeg Nation consider what will be included in the report and what won't be?
We're including everything. Like, I'm not going to miss out on certain things just because we think it's less priority. The more data and evidence that we provide, the better. And just, trying to, look at different avenues on how we're going to create priorities for the report, I think. So, like I said earlier, I'm noticing that one of the priorities is lands. So our Martin clan has huge interest and questions and as John was asking earlier about, the provincial laws coming into effect to ensure that UNDRIP is matching, the legislation there. But you're right, it's going to be hard.
And we've had a few sessions now. We started in July. And we're doing two sessions, obviously, one in the afternoon and one in the evening. So there's been a lot of feedback. And I believe that feedback is, I think we have some information on our website, right, Christy?
Yes, so I finally uploaded the videos. So the videos are on Anishinaabeg Nation on YouTube. So you'll be able to see the introduction, the Martin clan, the Eagle clan, Deer clan, Crane clan, and then today is the Turtle clan, and then we have three more clan sessions left to complete. We're recording it. We're going to be doing a paper on it, and we will be presenting it to like the chiefs, and the chiefs will be bringing it back and questioning us as well.
Excellent. Which I was going to ask where we can access previous discussions. Yeah, Christy said it's on our website and everything's on there.
I'll share it right now. So Anishinaabeg Nation. So we have all the sessions uploaded onto YouTube Anishinaabeg Nation channel.
Okay, we have another comment from Tanya. Oh, it's directly to me. So I'll read that and sorry, Tanya. I was going to read that out loud, but I'm not going to.
We will also have all the papers that the lawyers drafted up, uploaded onto our site. So Anishinaabeg Nation under our legal and then UNDRIP, all sessions and the articles, legal analysis will be uploaded there. So you can read further into some of what the lawyers are stating about the different clans and whatnot, on different issues within the clan system. Is there any other comments or concerns? I'll share my email. Individuals want to send me an email or, you know, send me something that you're concerned about in regards to criminal justice, I'll definitely note it and put it in our report.